thank you. I'd like to thank the organizer for inviting me. Let me first mention that this is a joint work with the two previous speakers, but it's not related to okay. So I want to sample from a log concave measure. So first, what's a log concave measure? I will take K, a convex body in my hand, and the dimension should be thought as large. And I take a function V from K to R, convex, and I will assume that it is smooth. And log concave measure is a measure which has a log concave density. So a density which is e to the minus convex function. So mu of dx will be e minus v of x times the indicator of k dx. And with a normalization constant, so this is just a normalized amount. Mu to be a probability measure. Okay, now the question is, I want to describe an algorithm to sample from you. Okay, so this is a problem that pops up in various areas. I won't address like the application, but there are many. Let me give the algorithm, give the theorem, and then I comment on the literature and so on. So here's the algorithm. So I start from a point anywhere, and I need CK to be an IIT sequence of standard motion variables on R. And now the algorithm goes as follows. At the K step, I am somewhere. I do this Gaussian jump, so I add this CK plus 1. Then I forgot to say something. There is a parameter eta. I will do a gradient descent step. So I will subtract eta over 2 times the gradient of the function d, which is over there, at the point xk, at the current point. Okay, so I am at xk, I do a Gaussian jump, I do a gradient descent, then maybe I'm out of k. So then I project back on k. Okay, where pk, this is the orthogonal projection. Okay, so this is k. The point x, pk of x is the one that minimizes the distance. Alright, and so that's the algorithm. And let me state the theorem. Okay.
Joseph? Maybe you want to multiply xi also by root of eta.
Good. I would have noticed at some point.
We'll never know.
Thank you. I'll comment later on this case, why this is a good thing. Let me say the theorem. Okay, so there are some hypotheses. So first of all, I will normalize K in such a way. So let me assume that K contains the Euclidean ball of radius 1, and it contains a larger ball. And okay, let me. Okay, I will state it in two parts. So first case, let me assume that V is constant. So V is a constant, meaning that I want to sample from the uniform measure only. Okay, so in this case, what we proved, so if you choose eta to be order n, order, okay, you choose eta of this order, you choose k order okay, r to the 6, n to the 7, over epsilon to the 8. Okay. Then xk, so your point, your random point after k steps, in total variation, it's epsilon close to the uniform measure on k. Okay, the statement is clear. I choose the parameter eta this way, as this, to this many number of steps, and then I have epsilon close to the uniform measure. Okay, let me state the theorem when V is not a constant.
Why do you work in a discrete time?
Why do I
work in discrete time? It is more natural to use the continuous time.
Yeah,
to have an idea of the proof in general, first you should try
You want me to work in continuous time, but this would change, this wouldn't change much. I mean,
no, but maybe the proof would be easier.
Okay, you too. Okay, just let me say, so when V is not a constant, so let me, for simplicity, I need to have some assumption on the gradient of V and the action of V. So let me assume that these two quantities are order one. Otherwise, I could state a theorem depending on this bound, but just for simplicity. Then you have the same result, you have to take your, so it's a little bit worse. You have to take K order R6, N to the 12, epsilon to the another number. It's not a big deal anyway. I mean, it's not important.
It also works if instead of n to the 12 you write poly n, and then it looks smaller.
Okay, so what is important is the dependence in the dimension. So what's non-trivial is the fact that you get something that's polynomial. Okay, maybe just to make this clear, let me give a naive algorithm that would give you something exponential. Just to make clear that this is not an obvious problem. So you have your convex body K, and you assume that it's in a large ball, simply in a large ball of radius R. Okay? So you could say, okay, this is how I will sample. I will draw points uniformly at random in this big ball, and the first time every time I check whether I am in K or not, the first time I am in K, I keep this point, and this will produce something that is uniformly distributed on K. The problem with this is that if you think of the dimension to be large, the ratio between this volume and this volume is exponential in this dimension. So you will have to wait exponential time for this to happen. Okay, so this doesn't work. Okay, so it's not trivial to get a polynomial time algorithm. Also, maybe some comment that I should make. I will not address the question whether how do I compute this orthogonal projection. Okay? I will not address this. This is my computational unit. Okay, don't challenge me. And Okay, now I think it's time to maybe talk a little bit about the existing literature, okay? So, this problem, so let's for simplicity, I will only describe the B equal constant case, which was the most unique case. So this question of sampling from a convex body was initiated by a series of papers. So I will not quote everybody, but so there's a series of papers by Kanan, Lovas, and Simonovic in the 90s. So there are several papers, and where they address and they show the existence of polynomial time algorithm for sampling from a convex body. So let me give only one result, which concerns an algorithm which is called the hit and run. And the hit and run algorithm goes as follows. So you have point xk, you pick a random direction, theta. Okay, so it's a random uniformly on the sphere. Then you move to xk plus 1, which is uniform. So it's uniform on the line okay, so this is my convex body K. I am here. Okay, so that's xk. I choose the direction theta. I look at the discord. And then I jump to xk plus 1 uniformly on the line. So it turns out, so this is called the hit and run. It turns out to be very efficient. Like it's maybe not so natural, but it's very efficient. And actually, you have a much better bound than what we get for our algorithm. So you get epsilon close to the uniform measure on k. So it's a little bit embarrassing because this is much better. I don't remember exactly things are. Something along this line. I don't remember exactly, but something much better. So you could ask, why am I bothering you with this? I don't have a very satisfactory answer to that. Okay, one thing you could I could say is that these are two algorithms that have a different nature. If you want, okay. This is a first order algorithm, meaning to do one step of the algorithm, you evaluate your function at a point. And this is a first order, this is a second order. You evaluate the gradient of your function. Okay, so in some cases you could think that it's more interesting to have it's easier to evaluate the gradient, but it's not so clear.
Make a mix of them. Because instead of using the uniform, which is not natural, it will give you the same weights near the boundary, but there should be less mass in some sense.
Yes.
So you could try a Gaussian restricted to that, to this segment maybe, and you have to find the good.
Right. I'm not sure it will work if you take a Gaussian because.
Oh, yeah.
Because, okay, what
hey, happens
no, with the hit and run is that...
Not a fixed variable. Okay. A variable which depends on the length of the segment, of course.
Okay, this I don't think it has been studied, so... How about
no, but if you change the variance for every step, then the stationary measure, you know, is inverse proportional to the variance, or something like that. So
maybe you have to be smart to do it.
That's not usually the case.
There is a smart way to do it actually, to change the variance continuously, yeah. But using.
But then you need to add
it. But you see, it would be between the two algorithms, so maybe.
But the real difference is really with the potential.
Frank, you take a count of the stuff, okay?
Sure.
And, okay, then I forgot what I was. Ah, yes, yes, yes. So, okay, my main motivation for studying this point is that actually this, this algorithm is very natural. And for me, it was a little bit of a surprise that it, I don't, at least we didn't find it, that it hadn't been studied yet. Like, at least it wasn't known, as far as I know, it wasn't known that this was converging in polynomial time. And I think it's a natural. So, on the theoretical point of view, it's interesting to know this.
So, Kanan actually told me that this was the first algorithm he looked at, but he couldn't prove polynomial time. He only could prove exponential.
Okay, I don't know Kanan, so I don't.
You had a Gaussian random variable which has a density which is very smooth. And your function there, you don't specify which degree of smoothness, so maybe you were better smooth.
Yeah, it's specified here, it's supposed to be any bound the second derivative.
So, yeah, so does it change something if you add a random variable with the density which is only too smooth? Mm-hmm. Not infinitely.
I'm using the fact that I mean I want a Gaussian because the Gaussian world is in what I know it better. But if I use some other variable, maybe I can still. I mean, by using central limit theorem or something, I can go back to the. I don't think it will change.
Do you obtain the density which has the right degree of smoothness?
Ah, you mean the density of.
Yeah. Yes, when you converge, you will obtain the density, the limit.
So this guy, so first of all, this guy doesn't have a density because it has a positive probability to lie on the boundary of the convex world. So it has an absolutely continuous part and a singular part. But the absolutely continuous part will be smooth, thanks to this. Yes, that is true. But this is not. I mean. We do not have access to the explicit density of this of course. This would be life would be easier. Okay, I was claiming that this is a very natural process. Now I will explain why. So there are two reasons why I can claim this. That, so first, if you come from a optimization if you do some optimization, this is very natural, okay? So if you remove this part, here what you are doing is just a stochastic a gradient descent. So if you don't put this part, your process xk will converge to the minimum of your function v over the convex body k. Now, it is known, and it has been studied, that if you add some noise, you can keep this property, and this was, for instance, this was disappeared in Vianney's talk yesterday, that if you put a noise here, you still converge to the minimum, provided your noise is small enough compared to this step. Okay, so I won't give the precise detail, but if you take here a random variable, I don't know, alpha k plus 1, which has a variance, which is of smaller order with respect to your gradient step here, then your guy here will converge to the minimum of your function. And so here I'm putting some bigger noise. Okay, my variance is exactly equal to eta. And then I don't converge anymore to the minimum, but still I have some incentive to go somewhere where V is small. Okay? And the truth is I'm going where at the end I have distributed according to this density which favors places with where V is small. Okay, so this is why one reason why this is natural. And the other reason, which was more my motivation, I think, is that this is the natural discretization of a continuous process, so Laurent will be happy. Which I will now describe. So I will now describe it into two steps. So because this projection is something, so I will deal with it at the end. So for the moment, let me assume that K is R to the n, so there is no projection, and I'm just looking at this guy. Okay. Alright, so I'm claiming that this is a natural discretization of a very natural continuous process, which is as follows. So let WT be a Brownian motion and let X, okay, let me change later. So let YT be the solution of this stochastic differential equation. So the increment of yt, there's a Gaussian increment, so this will be the analogon of this. And then there is a drift, and the drift is minus 1 half the gradient v at xt dt. So this is sometimes called the Langevin equation. Okay, so this is okay. If you're not familiar with stochastic calculus, don't worry. And anyway, I won't enter into the details. So this is just trust me that this is a very well studied and very well understood thing. And it's known that the solution yt is the Markov process, and that the stationary measure is precisely this measure. Okay? And for general reason, in particular, you see that so stationary measure means that if I start from a process which has the low mu, and I run the process, then I keep having the mu. And for generic reason, this converges to mu as t tends to plus infinity. Okay? Now, if I discretize this, I end up with this. Okay? And this was actually the starting point of our paper. It's a very nice analysis. Due to Dalagnan from last year, and let's try the following thing. Let's discretize this in this way. Okay, so I have my parameter eta, okay, my time step parameter, and I will use this process dyt, let me put tilde here. So I do this Brownian increment, and then I subtract 1/2 of the gradient V, and now instead of putting this, I will look at the gradient at the last integer multiple of eta. Okay, so I discretize time, and so the last, so probably this would be maybe, so this will be R, but eta integrator, so t over f, something along. Okay, more explicitly, if you look at y tilde k plus 1 times eta minus y tilde k times eta, it will be equal to y tilde k times eta plus, okay, the Brownian increment, so this will be minus, and on the integral k eta, k plus 1 eta, this is constant, so this is minus eta over 2 grad v y theta k times theta. Okay, so and this is the Brownian increment. This you can see below, this is the same as so the Brownian motion, it has stationary and dependent increments. So this is the same as putting I can always call it square root d square root theta ck plus 1. And I see that this y tilde at time k theta is the same as this xk. Okay. So now let me explain briefly.
Sorry, what's the resulting dandelion?
I'm doing the proof and I will say the result. Ah, yeah, okay, so here I am explaining Dalalian's argument. Okay. Okay, so now let me explain the Dalalian's ID. So you want to estimate the total variation between this xk and your stationary measure. So you write it, the total variation between my y t, between y tilde t and the stationary measure. And so I will just use the triangle inequality. Okay, and I have to deal with these two terms. So now I will make, so Dalalian makes an hypothesis. So here is the hypothesis, so there is two positive numbers such that, so it's not only assuming that V is convex, it's assuming that V is strictly convex. Okay. And some smoothness hypothesis. Okay, and now, so this hypothesis helps you to deal with this part, and this hypothesis to deal with this part. Okay. And now, okay, so let me explain this part. So I will use this hypothesis here. So once you are in this situation, you can now invoke the celebrated Bakri-Emrick criterion. So I will use Bakri-Emrick, which has yet to be mentioned in this conference. And it's kind of a rule to mention this at some point for a conference in Toulouse. So I'm doing it. Okay, so if you don't know what it is, first, don't say it aloud. And second, basically, it's a curvature condition that tells you that, so in this case, it tells you that under this assumption, your process is well behaved and you will converge exponentially fast to the stationary measure. So you will show that this it converges with weight e minus alpha t. So here I'm cheating a little bit, there is a pre-processing, so for instance it will be true if I put the key distance here between what you have at time 0 and mu, and so you have pre-processing to do to make sure this is finite, but okay, I don't want to enter into the detail, but anyway, this converges to 0 exponentially fast, so you're happy. Now you want to deal with the second part, and what Dalalian does. So you see that the dy tilde t, okay, let me not give the detail. What Dalalian does is that he uses Girsanov for okay, so, and it's very, okay, It's very elegant and it works very well. And at the end, he finds that if you take eta to be something which I don't remember, and the number of steps to be order something that I have not here, so. Okay, that's the dimension. Then your process xk is epsilon close to your target measure.
You really need Gersanov's theorem to control the difference between the finite step approximation and the process itself, because it looks like since you have an upper bound on the Hessian, everything should be bounded, so if you move a bit, you're going to change just
yes,
a bit.
Yes, but if you do this, you will bound some transport distance between the process, but you won't.
What's
you
wrong
want,
with that?
I want total variation. This is the natural thing. So the idea is that I to bound the total variation, I will use Pinsker. So first bound the relative entropy, and for this Gersanov was okay. So now I don't have time, and okay, I will be very brief, but just okay. So now what we what I want to argue is that my process, when there is a convex body and I project on K, is also the discretization of some continuous time process. Okay, and I want to explain very briefly what is this continuous time process. Okay, so for simplicity, let me assume that B is a constant, so I'm only sampling from a convex body, so my algorithm does this. Right, so so what's the continuous process to which this is a discretization? So it's called the reflective Brownian motion. So let me give just the equation. So you have dxt is, so you have a Brownian increment, and then you have a process of this form. Okay, well, so LT it's a measure, so it's a random measure, which has the property that the support of L is included in, okay, first of all, this process XT, it belongs to K for all time. It remains, so the Brownian motion goes everywhere, but xt it remains in k. And this measure here, its support is included in the set of times where xt belongs to the boundary of k. Okay, so this Brownian motion, it goes wherever it wants. And this part is the one that pushes you inside k. Okay, but it only pushes you when you're at the boundary. So that was it. And to be NUT is outer normal at X. Okay, so it was shown in a very nice article by Tanaka that this is well defined. I mean, this exists, this is. Okay. And now I want to explain why. Okay, this guy is the discretization, because Actually, Tanaka, if you. Okay. So you discretize your Brownian motion. So you say WT dat is equals the Brownian motion at time at your integer step. Okay, so at time eta times t over eta. And you let xt dat t to be the reflection of wt dat t. Okay? And it's actually, it's exactly this. So you will have okay, so that's.
I guess I don't have much time to explain more. But
just to conclude, so then we sort of copy the line of reasoning of Dalagnan, that is we want to we want to upper bound this, and okay. So as in the article, and now actually now this will be the beginning of another talk. Is that actually neither of Dalagnan's steps applies. So here, maybe for this guy. So here I didn't say it, but this effect in Brownian motion is a Markov process and the stationary measure is mu. So here you need to estimate the speed of convergence of xt towards mu, but you're not anymore in a situation where you can apply back freely. Okay, your alpha is zero if you want. So you have to do something else. Okay? And here you're not in a situation where you can apply Kirsanov either, because if you know what Kirsanov is, this kind of process is not absolutely continuous with respect to the Brownian motion. So again you have to do something else. And okay, that's it. Thank you.